Why and what are business plan, and also make you do an interactive exercise. You know, we have mentors attached to each of you, so that we can help you think through, you know, how do you think about your business models and what's scalable and sustainable in the future for you. So we'll cover some of those issues, but before I get started into the whole business plan exercise, and you know, it's not a topic that's new to any of you. I've heard about this many times over the show. So what I want to do is, before we start, if I can just go around the room, especially I'm talking to the enterprises here. If you can tell me, what is your expectation? You know, what do you expect to get at the end of this session? So we, you know, we ensure that you get that outcome. Output as I was told by a mentor yesterday. So if I can just, you know, go around the room and have you tell me what is it that you expect to learn from this session, so we ensure that, you know, we are capturing some of those things, because I don't want it to be a, you know, a one-dimensional thing where we come and tell you what we should be doing, and I want to make it really interactive. I want to see that, you know, I want to ensure that we are meeting an expectation at the end of the session. So for the next 1.5 hours, we'll spend time talking about this plan. So I'm not coming point to you unless, you know, if you guys can just go and tell me some of the expectations. Prashant here just capture some of the, and we'll go back and take off some of those and see if you are able to meet something. Yeah? So, who wants to start? What is it that we can help you with today? What is it that you want to learn about? Because it's not a topic that's new to you. If I can go to you, then maybe, what would you
think?
Me? Yes.
Well, you know, oftentimes when you make a plan, internally you would not put certain things which you know, people know, or, you know, details. What kind of detailing is required if you are, you know, making a pitch to an outsider?
Okay. And when you say outsider, would that be investor?
Investor.
Anything? Yes.
I'd like to know about how to be realistic but yet optimistic in terms of sales numbers.
Sales target.
Yeah.
So did you pick it? Anything? What is he going to
do? Sorry, I'm going to do anything.
No, what is he
going to do? No, I'm doing it for the last 40 minutes, so.
Anything that you are kind of curious about? So. No? Anything from you? We should be able to cover all of it, I think, except for the fact that, you know, the difference between social enterprise and social business. I think that's a conversation we'll have to pick up, if not in this session. I'm hoping by the end of the day you will have some clarity on this aspect, because this is a little bit of a debate, and I'm not really sure we are equipped to, you know, deal with the debate right now, but I'll be happy to speak to you more about it and, you know, what the real differences are. You have a lot of enterprises today, so you should interact with them and get to know a little bit more. But, you know, by the end of the day, you don't have your answers, you should reach back to Aparajita wherever she is, and you ensure you get your answers from her. Because this session is more designed around business plan and business model. I am not sure that you will be able to get it. But everything else, we should definitely be able to find. Yeah. And so with that, I'll hand it over to Anurag Khare, my colleague, who will walk you through. Okay, so I guess I can probably start you off. So before, again, you know, another question for the group. When you think of business plan, like you said, right, how do you pitch to investors? Is that the only purpose you see for your business plan, or are there other ways in which you use your plan?
Yeah, we make a business plan to set a roadmap for ourselves, you know, internally, what to achieve, how much, you know, and obviously then work backwards about creating the necessary production facility and other things.
So you do,
so
use it
we do that, but what I'm saying is when you go to your investor, like when we do an internal plan, a lot of things are assumed, people know, then you don't put it there.
Correct.
But when you go to an investor, what kind of detailing is required? That's
right.
Why I'm keen to, you know.
So, okay, so your really answer to this question is that not only do you use it for investor, but you are actually using business plan as an internal roadmap, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Investor is the last thing.
Sorry?
Investor comes in the last.
The business plan is critical to your own organization. Investor really needs to. And what are the challenges that you face when you, so one is definitely that you articulated that you know the level of detail that needs to go into a business plan, that's one. Are there other challenges that you come across as you think through your business plans? Because you know my own experience is that I create and I'm creating a business plan for the consulting practice and in healthcare, and what happens is I do PPT or you know that PowerPoint or that Word document only once a year, and it very often happens that I don't go back and look at it for a year. You know, it becomes more of a spreadsheet exercise. And the only time you go back and revisit your business plan is only in terms of your numbers and revenue targets and margins. That's the only purpose that's really done for business plan often. You just make it a spreadsheet exercise and that's where it ends. Very rarely do you go back and actually look at, you know, what was the roadmap that you laid out, what are the partners that you're thinking about, the strategy part of it. So it just continuously evolves and you hardly ever capture it. And I'm hoping that at the end of today's session, you know, we are able to show you why it's important to, you know, not just make it a special exercise, but go beyond that. And, you know, focus on what you're putting out there. So, with that, I'll hand it over to Anurag, who will take you through the what, how, and why of this plan. And Prashant will moderate the session with him.
So, hello and welcome everybody in this boot camp. We will try to make this this section interactive, and we will do an exercise. But before we lead up to that exercise, I'll quickly go on through some of the concepts that why do we need business plan, and what are the common mistakes that have been observed. So, what and why of business plan? Now, if you see, there are five basic functions of management: planning, organizing, staffing, directing, and controlling. While for theoretical purposes, we can separate them out. So for example, planning is about deciding in advance what to do, when to do, how to do. Organizing is about delegating the responsibilities, organizing the activity, dividing them up. Staffing is your human resource planning, putting right men to the right job, putting square pegs into square holes and the right round pegs into the round holes. Directing is little bit more interpersonal exercise where you are motivating the team, directing them, providing leadership, offering communication. And controlling is setting the standards and measuring against this. So while for theoretical purposes we can separate them out, but actually these are very interrelated functions. And that interrelation manifests in a business plan. So business plan, you do it for today, but also for 5 years down the line. So it's a futuristic in orientation. It's an intellectual activity because you have to go through a systematic thinking of how you're going to achieve the goals that you set out for. It will help you avoid confusion, uncertainties, and risk. So why we need a business plan? Now, when Nisha was taking feedback, some of you mentioned that one of the most important purpose of having a business plan, use it like a compass. When you are progressing in your enterprise journey, you will measure the performance against a set goal that you have started with. You also use it for a business loan to raise equity capital. You also use it to communicate with the board or hiring the senior resource, the key personnel, in order to share your vision with them. And in case you want to value your business plan is definitely very important. And when you decide to sell your business, again it's important. Now, what are some of the common mistakes that people make in business plan? Lot of time people avoid, so they put off creating a business plan. And so, to the extent that you are a sole proprietor, you are the only one running the show, probably it might work. But the moment you have a team and you want to communicate with the external world, with the investors, at that time you do need a business plan. The other common mistake that is seen in many of the business plan is idea inflation. So great thing happens with a good idea, but in the business plan, it's not a very good thing to overestimate the idea, because idea has to be backed up by a well thought out, robust implementation plan, which should also identify the challenges that you will face in implementing the those ideas. So investor don't necessarily invest in an idea, they invest in the people who have the ability to execute an idea. We also see sometimes people have very lofty goals in the business plan, while the objective of the business plan is to produce result. And while the having a very lofty goal is good, but if it doesn't produce result, it doesn't have any value. Cash flow casualness, this is something we see very often, because I think we are wired, we are trained to think in terms of sales minus expenses. But unfortunately, we don't pay our bills through profit, we pay it through cash. And cash is something we take to the bank. So as an enterprise, having that cash flow understanding is very important. Somebody mentioned about the projections, I think, the lady from the PWS. Now, in many business plans, we see that you have sales projections which are really in suddenly in second year or third year, you have very high sales projection. The idea is to keep it realistic, keep it something that is achievable, because one of the feedback that comes from the investor is that most of the enterprise, although they make a business plan, they rarely stick with that. They rarely achieve numbers. So having your sales projection realistic and tuned to the ground reality is important. Coming back to one of the feedback that we received, how do we deconstruct our business plan? What are the main components? There are five main components. Apart from executive summary of company overview, where you talk about what's the company history, what's the legal structure, whether it's a for-profit, private limited, or it's a Section 25 company. But the next five are the really most important components of a business plan. We start with an external environment, where you will look outside, how the market looks like, what is the analysis, who are the customer, what is your product, what kind of service that you want to deliver. That's an external environment scanning. Then you come to the business model part of the business plan, where you talk about what is the value proposition that you are offering to your customers, what is the operating model that you are using to deliver that value, what is your marketing and sales plan. That will constitute the business model. Then you talk about your management team, what are the key personnel, what is their experience. Why are you a winning team? I mean, in a combination of the team members, are you covering all the management function? You have capability to produce result. That's where your management team structure comes in. And then of course, the financial plan, where you talk about profit and loss statements, where you talk about the cash flow statements, where you talk about what's the capital requirement, when is your business going to break even. That is constitute the financial plan. And then you also look at the what are the key risks in your business? What are the limiting factors? What are the key success factors? Because an investor, if you are thinking about the, presenting it to the investor, then they also want you to be realistic that not everything is an ideal situation. You might face obstacles. So it's an important ability and a very good ability to anticipate them in advance. Out of all these components, what we see is that on the business model side, the kind of rigor that is required is sometimes lacking. So there is an implicit assumption about thinking through the business model, but there is a lack of structured approach in coming out with the right kind of business model. And that's what we have selected you for, to do this exercise on the business model, where what we want you, and we have a we are giving you a canvas, and we want that you paint your business model on this particular canvas. It has 9 sections: key activities, key partners, key resources, value prop, customer relationships, segments, channels, cost and revenue stream. Now what we are going to do, we are going to divide you in teams and we have one moderator from IntelliCap who will work with you in coming up with the business model for your
inference.
So I think GB moderator is not right. So if you can.
Yes, just so that you have a reference of what's being done.
So if you can see, according to the standard, group 1, Bhushan Agro and EcoTusser, I think EcoTusser is that kind, and Bhushan Agro, if you can go there, then you can work with Prashant as a moderator, and he will help you in coming out with the specific of this business model exercise. Group 3, you have Claro. So Claro and Grameen, yeah. So if you can come here.
It's easier for moderators to work with
you. So Srikant.
Yes.
Srikant will work with you guys.
It is.
So Gram Tarak, we can work with you. And Sautilya and Kanungo, you are already there. So Raghav is working with you. Now the objective of this exercise before you start is that don't just look at the business model as it is as of today, but also look in future. How will it look like 3 years, 5 years down the line? Think it through. Because business model is one of the most important part of the business plan. And if you have got that right, the majority of the part of business plan is done. So we will come back once you are done with this exercise to the learning. And in addition, you have Nisha, Manish, you can raise your hand. If you need any help, please call them out.
We will be fine. But this will help you detail out exactly where the fund is. Tomorrow, if you are going for an investor, you know exactly which area of your business impact you are
investing.
We believe that it's your responsibility to translate whatever happens here in your actual thing on the
market.
But this helps you think through and communicate to your
aspects. We have done a plan.
You are done a plan.
Yes.
So this plan,
but this Texas Bapata medicine. आपको कोई साइड इफेक्ट नहीं है, बट टैक्सेस बकाटा ग्रो करना अपने आप में टफ है। 20 साल में बड़ा होता है, धीरे 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 बढ़ता है। हमारे गांव के लोग तो क्या करते हैं, टैक्सेस बकाटा का पकड़ा लेते हैं, आगे से रेड पोर्शन काट के पीछे का पोर्शन दाल में डालते हैं। हम लोग कैंसर होता ही नहीं, अगर महीने साल में एक महीना बारिश नया बारिश होता है
So, if we should have a discussion with Rebecca, So our category is very similar to our category that we have exposure to. The good goal is to discuss channel sales and how we can cross values.
Any comments there?
Yeah, so I mean the risks that will come into the picture when we try to replicate our success in various areas as we move on. So those risks could be different, from the risks that they're facing now.
Right.
The 3 years down the line is totally different. So that's a different topic. Well, it kind of helps you to think in a more structured manner. You intuitively you keep doing certain things, and but then when you looked at this template, you see alternatives, then you start thinking about how does it apply to your business. But that is another thing which Prasanth said, that have you ever tried comparing with other similar kind of organizations?
Right.
So you're still
exercise.
I think this exercise has helped us analyze our business a little bit better in terms of one, how do we portray ourselves in terms of, because healthcare industry is sometimes difficult to explain, and getting those thoughts in order allows us to explain our business and what exactly are we trying to achieve in a far better manner.
Oh, that's okay. Yes.
We surpassed the things.
So it was. It's intuitive, right?
Absolutely.
You were doing. I know we made you something which, like, back of your handbook. Any insights?
Lots of license.
That's awesome. You were able to make your life done for an awesome episode. That's the purpose.
I felt good. Really fast.
I was thinking you were visiting future. Mm-hmm. You were visiting Park Best of Alright, so with that, I would just, like to call upon moderators, people who are moderating the groups. Are there any things that, that you want to highlight in terms of, the challenges that you work with? Or any specific themes that you watch? So,
it would be difficult to say it's a theme all across, because I haven't visited all the groups, but we know our business plan very well. We understand what the reasons are, but when an outsider looks at it, be it a jury member or an investor, he typically comes from a diverse background and he knows what the inherent risks are in your business. We currently look at, as an entrepreneur, we mostly look at what is the most optimistic picture, and I have covered most cases. But within each of your elements which was laid out on that sheet, there are a lot of interdependencies and the risks which we at times don't give as much importance. And that's something which we have to keep in mind, because those are typically the direct questions that we face. And because the optimism and the projections are good, but at what cost is going to be the first question. And I think that's something which an exercise like this would help you understand beyond just getting your business logic and the pieces to it.
So the group that you were working with, was there an area where you found that they were struggling more than others?
No, I wouldn't say there was a struggle, but to understand a lot of interdependencies, for example, I was working with on the healthcare aspect. For example, there are consultants and doctors involved in your delivery of service. You don't have a control over that particular aspect of the business. How do you get doctors? How do you retain doctors? They tend to be like 70% of your cost in any healthcare delivery. How do you get them? How do you retain them? In most important question, you would have massive 5-year projection. You don't have doctors and they have hospitals. So if you are going to do a scale up, then that's the most important critical resource for you. And the risks which are attached to getting that aspect there. So some similar pieces would be there in each business. And that's something which we have to be very cognizant of while presenting it to anyone. And when you are asked to make a pitch in 2 minutes, we need to know exactly what those interdependencies are and make them clear that they are covered on this.
Shikha,
can
you think? Yeah.
Sorry, just to add to what Rafa was saying, also from a social entrepreneurship point of view, you generally start a business in an area or in a region where there is a comfort zone.
for example, the example of doctor and nurse, you typically do it in an area where you might have contacts. And you do it and you would have all the, you know, sort of wherewithal of getting access to the resources. But the minute you think about scaling up and you say, okay, I would expand from X to X plus 100% in the next 2 years, which means that you've got to go out of the comfort zone and your region. And you might not expand into new regions, and you won't have that buffer, which typically you take for granted. So ideally within this plan, you know, when we're doing this exercise, that's what you need to comprehend. Yes.
So in my question, I have a couple of points that I'm waiting for us as well. So one aspect is that often, business models have, each business model has a lot of elements to it. And often there are one or two critical elements which make or break the model. You know, everything else is probably status quo, and then one or two things which would determine whether the model scales up or not. So I think that's one outcome, you know, of the discussion that happens. So identifying that crucial or critical aspect of the model. What exactly is that? So I think that's one.
So
it
levers. In a sense, you know, where does it
really
have most leverage? What is
the what is the, yeah? Or the dependency on the scale, you know, like what scale is really, and then attaching the right level of resources and the importance and significance of effort and all of that. So that's one. Secondly, I think the for instance, let's say there's a problem of supply chain responsiveness. So that's a global problem, and a lot of companies, you know, every product company in the world faces that problem. So now, if you're in the business of supply chain, I mean, if supply chain is integral to the business, then there will be choices. So there will be strategic choices that it could be increasing the inventory cost and passing the price to the customer, or it could be, you know, there will be n number of ways to deal with that. So while creating a business plan itself, it's very difficult to anticipate such a problem and then include it in the problem. I'm sure like no business plan has a section on that, but it's only experience when implementing it. So the business model, as I was saying, it will keep evolving, and when you say business model, right, so all these choices will effectively make the business model together. So ideally, if you can articulate your business model in the form of choices, you know, like 3 or 4 choices, and if they are interconnected and strengthening the entire model, that will be the best. So those choices, so basically the bottom line of, you know, the second aspect would be that if you can clearly lay down your choices and then, you know, pick one to deal with the problem that you're facing, and if that forms into building your model. So that's also, so basically these are all themes.
I think one of it is already said. One additional point that I want to bring out is when we were plotting the business model on the canvas, and in this particular case there was an intention to start an additional business line, then what we could establish is that we are able, better equipped to start that business line is because on my canvas I have a good relationship with my customer segment. And to the same customer segment, I am offering an additional service which will create a new revenue stream, a new business. So, that providing that structured approach helps to first think through it and also clearly communicate when it will go to the stage of going to the bank or investor.
Right. Anything, Manish?
Yes, so just the point that the canvas is a good tool. You can use it. To kind of look at how the business flows out of it. So when you do the business plan, it's always good to go to the canvas first, do it there, and then start thinking about business plans. Otherwise, what's going to happen is that a lot of elements of the model you are going to take as assumption. And when a change is required there, and if you miss out on making that change when on your sheet or on your business plan, then that's not going to help you. So do the canvas first and then kind of get into the nitty-gritty of doing the business plan.
Thank you. Yeah, so I'll, you know, hand it over to Prashant, do you want to add to it?
Yeah, I'll just quickly make a couple of operations. So, I think clearly one of the issues with which you see in these businesses and this is the early stage and the growth stage, and the trend in the early stage, there's a lot of capital that you need to put in. And you need to do a proof of concept or not even for it. It's very capital intensive. But you know that once you've done it, the market is highly scaled. The issue is often in terms of how much capital you have to build it. And also, the issue is whether you find the right kind of investor for the kind of model that you, for the business that you have, and whether he is aligned to the kind of time frame that you're working with. Or intrinsically, to make the business itself sustainable, you could also look at how you want to make additional streams of revenue that are aligned to the core business or the core competence that is doing to the business, which will also allow you to generate internal resources as to supplement any additional capital that you need for it. It depends a lot on what kind of investor you are. And the kind of investor could be different based on kind of requirements that you have, the kind of time frame, payback, and the rest. So that's just one. And the other one is interesting is how do you manage your working capital and your costing and income from early stage to scale and be able to manage whether you have mitigated all the risks. Are the risks the same? But are they different when you actually move from, I think one of the points which was made earlier is you move from the region that you already operated to a region. You find that the context of the model does not remain the same. And some of the levers change. And these are not always captured in the trends of the model itself. Because these are underlying factors. And you taking them as assumptions that they would exist and this is how you build your model based on that. You find those assumptions change. So to be able to revisit that is what you would do with the model and the canvas. The canvas is, allows you to identify some key metrics which you would be able to track on an ongoing basis of the business, which I'm sure everybody does. In terms of the Excel sheet and this. But it also allows you to revisit the structure of the business itself and the constituents of the various drivers and the levers and this and see whether those which you built maybe a year ago or 6 months ago and if the industry changes very quickly or whatever it is that business actually grew up, whether you need to be able to chop and change something, whether that metric itself is wrong or the metric is showing you that you need to make some change in the way you run the business. Those, that's the basic objective. So the business model is a pretty organic. It's not meant to be a static device that you just create and you make it and you start running. It just helps you be more structured in the way you approach. I'm sure most people do this, but it's all, it's, if you do it in a more structured way, it just allows you to think through smaller things. I think we'll just quickly summarize with a few points. So I think the point I was making is that your business plan is a document you share with investors, that's typically what most people make plans for. And then they often shelve it because they don't actually read it. Because you clearly find that as an entrepreneur, you made a plan, you got in the field, and you found that most times the plan is completely useless because the dynamics on the ground are completely different. So we go with the basic premise that this is possibly true in most cases. So you should use your business model feeding into your business plan, but the model itself is nothing but a tool for figuring out how you should manage your business and how you should chop and change the various drivers and this point of origin. And is that we don't want you to make it just a spreadsheet exercise, which is something that you would do anyways. Most people would do this in spreadsheets to begin with, later on you'll have your MIS systems and the rest. The idea of Canvas is to be able to take a slightly more big picture view, step out of the chaos, and basically look at the business and figure out whether what you're doing makes sense from good, from forward looking perspective, not just from here. I mean, at the end of the day, you make your plan, you make your model and invest. What the investor really wants to know is whether you can execute the plan. And the plan may look good, and he knows that you're going to change it once you get or once you actually raise the capital. But he needs to know that the plan is robust, more importantly, you can execute it the best manner. So I think that just sort of sums up. Thanks a lot for being a good audience, and it's been a great interaction.
Okay, thank you everyone. We'll now break for lunch and
ever measured the impact that your business has created other than just the financial metric? No. Yeah. Could you share what have you
tried? So we measure the impact by the number of people that our product reaches and the lives that it impacts. So for our particular case, so we make cook stoves. So it impacts the entire family because you're cooking food on it, emits less smoke, fuel consumption. So smoke impacts the children and the women in the family. So we take an average household size, you know, and that's how we measure our social impact. The number of people that we, our cook stove has directly and, you know, indirectly impacted. So direct impact is for the woman who's using the stove, you know, she can, number of benefits. But the smoke, the indirect pollution that we reduce impacts the entire family. So number of stoves sold into the number of families that we reach is a direct number that we have.
Anybody else? So if I'm over a district in Srikakulam, here we work. We have 1,000 agents in this district. And every year we distribute 150 crores government money. So this is our intervention, I mean the money is being given to the panchayats. So they were actually giving money to 6 lakh people, 6 lakh beneficiaries.
Right.
But the fact is there are only 4 lakh beneficiaries, the remaining 2 lakh are done beneficiaries. And even the 4 lakh beneficiaries who are supposed to get X amount, they are being paid X minus something.
Right.
So post our intervention, we were able to aim it on the 2 lakh beneficiaries and the people who are supposed to get the entire amount. We were able to provide that.
So we look at it in terms of two or two parameters. The first is being, so we employ solar powered water pumping devices for irrigation. So we measure the amount of land that receives insured irrigation. Because the areas we operate in, we don't get insured irrigation because of lack of electricity and high cost of water level. So A is that. B, we also measure the number of people we directly or indirectly employ in these places. In these places. C, we measure the annual savings that each family or household will get.
This is the one part. But the other part, that's my question. It's not,
okay.
There are a lot of other impacts are also impacted with this, which we never measure. Like, I told you on a story, there is one guy who has not been, he was a drinker, he did not do anything. We have employed him as an operator. Now he is working over there. Now based on his income, now his son is now going to school. Now his wife is getting married. So those types of impact we never measure. I think that's the question. How to measure those impacts?
Why did you want to measure impact? I mean, what is the purpose? Why do you measure impact? Is it because you identify yourself as a social enterprise, or is it because you are again the investor which helps you pitch better? Why do you think we need to measure?
Because investors will always look at returns.
We will come back to that point. So why is that a myth that investor only looks for return? We'll come back to it.
But you know, just in your own businesses, why do you think, you know, is it because it's my
business? It's a combination of everything, because I talked about Srikakulam business. So if I want to garner more business, I think definitely, you know, we joined the APR, Garudadhyaya, and I think this is what I've done in Andhra Pradesh.
Right.
And in case it's like an opportunity to work in your state. I can replicate the same, you know, innovation here also, and I can ensure that, you know, industry is done, you know, without.
So if I can paraphrase, you're saying that it helps you tell your story better, right? I mean, it gives more meat
to your
story.
So, what we'll be looking at this presentation is, what is social impact measurement? What is its importance? How can we develop and track these social impact indicators? And like we did in the earlier session, we're going to do a quick exercise just for your enterprises. And to your point, let's try and see how can we be comparable. So, first question is, do you measure social impact? And what do you measure in that? So if you look at an enterprise, going beyond just the financial aspects of it, you touch lives across these four segments: retail employees, retail consumers, the environment for the producers and intermediaries. These could either be because they are a direct mission or vision of your enterprise, and that's why you are a social enterprise. And there could also be few metrics which are incidental, or few impacts as you have mentioned, which are incidental to our activities but very important. So, any economic intervention is an indirect impact which is created by the enterprise, but it was still there. So, these are the social outcomes or outputs that an enterprise creates when they operate in the segment they operate in. And we know and we agree that some of these are important, but why is it important to measure the social impact? One is to realign yourself to the mission and vision with which you started your enterprise. It helps you to benchmark your performance with the others in the industry and see whether you are on course, you are ahead of the curve, or you have created some innovation altogether. At the same time, from a startup phase to the growth phase, as your employee base grows, the value that you transfer to the employees is quantified one way or the other. Second, coming back to this point, capital raising and investor report, extremely important going forward. And they identified for the first time somebody called a social venture fund. Earlier there was just venture fund, now there is a social venture fund. If any fund is registered as a social venture fund, they have to justify the impact that they create. And the fund as such doesn't create an impact, it's the investees that create the impact. And how is the fund going to measure that impact? If you as an enterprise measure the impact, the investor is going to know that impact that you create. As simple as that. And these are regulations. We are not saying this because it's a social venture fund and so it goes. At the same time, you can align with the investors that you want to align with. One is a conventional early stage investor, and there is an impact investor as the market sees now. An impact investor generally wants to invest in enterprises which are socially aligned. And he looks at this as a common template where I can see whether there is an impact created. And it improves credibility in this pool of impact investors. Third, the building of your market value and communication strategy is extremely important. You can differentiate your product from somebody else's product purely based on the impact that you create for the community. Maybe your product is priced at a premium, but your product is differentiated. The kind of communication strategies which you can develop using these metrics will help you communicate the story in a way that you impact so many lives of the stakeholders that you operate with. It's extremely important. There's three things: mission focus, fundraising, investor reporting, communication and branding side. People generally undermine these two and they just focus on what is my vision and mission is. But going forward, the other two aspects of capital raising and building market value are going to be very important. And those are the tools of your marketing. So, if this is so important, then how do we go about doing this? Two approaches. First approach is use off-the-shelf products. There are two available in the market, very famous. One is called as GIRS, Global Impact Investment Reporting System. And the other is IRIS. What is GIRS? GIRS is a comprehensive set of ratings and performance system that is promoted by V-Labs in the US. And what GIRS has provided you is it covers all the sectors in which most social enterprises operate across the world in different regions at different sites, and they offer you frameworks which you could use. The assessment is administered, validated and managed completely by GIRS, and it's their people and their subcontractors. The other option, Impact Reporting and Investment Standards IRIS. This is unlike GIRS, which is a semi-online, semi-offline kind of a medium. IRIS is completely online and it is promoted by the Global Impact Investment Network, GIIN. What IRIS offers is similar to GIRS. It has a set of database of indicators across industries. As an enterprise, you can choose the indicators that you have and input your data and continue tracking it. And it's completely managed by the enterprise. But what we have found is, while working with both GIRS, IRIS and social enterprises who are trying to use this, these are very difficult to manage given the stage of enterprise you are.
or even if you grow to a certain extent, it's very difficult to manage. One, the process is fairly elaborate. For example, in Geese, it requires a person, a subcontractor, to travel to your company, evaluate, report it back to Geese. It requires substantial amount of your time, which goes into tracking it. Documentation is required for you to submit. Every time your iris requires you to input data all the time. And that many of these metrics may not be even what you want to track. Or you want to track a particular metric, that may not be there. So it becomes exclusionary on many occasions and difficult to access given the stage of the enterprise. Maybe if the enterprise becomes like a massive organization, maybe iris and Geese standard accepted across the world, it becomes easy to use. But at this stage, what we can do is a simple do-it-yourself. Metrics that you want to measure and that you derive from the activities that you do with. It's as simple as 3 steps of how you do an impact. I'll just take you through an example that will help you understand how you can do or impact measurement. I will start right from the vision and mission of an enterprise. It's an hypothetical enterprise which operates with bamboo artisans. But let's see from just the mission and vision, the kind of metrics that enterprise is able to track or is willing to track going forward. So, are you guys with me? Mission and the vision of this enterprise is to ensure sustainable livelihood for bamboo artisans by creating quality handmade bamboo products on the principles of fair trade. That was the mission of this particular enterprise. The first step towards building our own metrics in a simple do-it-yourself format would be to break this down, this vision or mission, into 3 or 4 main goals of the enterprise. So for this bamboo artisan enterprise, one was straightforward, provide sustainable livelihood to bamboo production. Second, revive the tradition of bamboo handmade handicrafts. The third one is to educate consumers, as I was saying, the importance of social metrics. You have to sell your product, the communication strategy. Educate your customers on bamboo handmade products and the ethical trade or the stamp of ethical products that are made from this particular enterprise. The fourth one is minimize the negative environmental impacts. By no means these are very exhaustive goals for this particular enterprise, but yes, the 4 main goals that flew straight away from the mission and vision of the enterprise. Does that make sense? The next step is to derive activities that are associated with each goal. They provide sustainable livelihoods to bamboo craftsmen. The way this company thought they could do it is to form community-owned companies. Just like Fab India did or any other company that's running the world, create an artisan-owned business. And for the artisans who don't want to be owners, provide employment to bamboo artisans. Third thing as a part of creating livelihoods is imparting skills. very important in just giving maybe a job or value. To revive the tradition of bamboo handmade and increase the existing range of bamboo crafts and arts that we see in the market or that the company currently has. Educate the customers on bamboo, promote the aesthetics and ethics concept to the consumer. So, have a concept or your communication strategy of why these products are ethical and promote this aspect using your branding strategy going forward. Minimize the negative impact of operations. So, while creating bamboo artifacts, this enterprise was using a lot of chemical effluents. And these are harmful to the enterprise, to the environment. So, the enterprise said we are going to treat the effluents before they are released to the environment so that the negative impact that these effluents cause are minimized. So, once you define what these activities are, we have to see what output that we desire from these activities. One, increase the participation of bamboo artisans in the community. When you provide employment to bamboo artisans, increase the household income or the standard of living. Improve the skills and employability and productivity of employees. Expand the enterprise's model of artisan communities to additional geographies. Currently, they are operating in Rajasthan, but they want to take it to Eastern Uttar Pradesh going forward. Increase the awareness in buyers about the story behind the product. Operate, you see a bigger tags coming with every fabric that is coming out of such an enterprise. They are trying to educate the consumer exactly as to what was the story behind creating such a fabric for them. And the final output from the treatment will reduce water pollution to the water bodies in the regions in which they operate. So now you started with vision. You have broken down your vision into four goals. Each goal had a set of 2 to 3 activities. The best practice is to restrict it to 2 to 3 activities and not make a laundry list. So you start with a laundry list, prune it to the focus areas, 2 to 3 activities that are very critical to your business or pretty important for conveying your story to the investors or your communication and branding, and then associate outcome story. What we do next is for each outcome, there's a metric. And all the metrics that we calculate or we track in this framework are all quantitative. None of them are qualitative. So what are the quantitative? Is it visible in the
back?
Number of artisan shareholders in the community owned company, sorry, I call it owned company. How many of these shareholders were from economically backward communities? Number of women shareholders. These are all metrics which talk to any impact investor or any development agency out there in the market. Women, underserved geographies, backward communities, number of women artisans in the operations. Skill trainings conducted, it's again something as an enterprise you conduct number of trainings you are able to track. Total number of employees and artisans who attended this. So, in terms of efficiency of the programs that you conduct, number of geographies in which you have operations, new styles of craft that you have generated. So, if there are 100 styles in which the craft is already in practice, if you have brought in 101st craft to the market, that's an important service that you have done to the art itself. We are going this beyond the impact that you have created on the society. Sales that you have through the ethical trade organization, so you got a branding of your products being of ethical trade, so what are the sales that you have generated, the volume of effluent that you created, something which you missed earlier was income per bamboo artisan from entrepreneur. So you are saying that the income that you created helped them
with their livelihood and, you know, sustenance activities as well as improving their status in society. So when we have each of these metrics and we want to calculate them, if you look at the metrics which are listed in row column E, these are something which you have already in your enterprise in your business. All you have to do is put them together to form a quantitative indicator for you. Total number of shareholders for this enterprise was available ready. How many of them were women were ready available? Number of artisans from disadvantaged or economically backward communities that was available. So the decision you have to make here is identify which of these are already there with you and you track, so that your overhead of doing this separately is reduced. At the same time, at what frequency are you going to measure them? So if you have shareholders, they are not going to change like monthly. Maybe they change quarterly, or maybe half yearly, or maybe annually. So for each of these indicators, you have to find what is the reporting frequency at which you measure. So what you already have available, at what frequency you measure. The moment you complete the third step, you have created a social impact measurement framework for yourself. On a plain piece of paper, overhead is minimized. But we also say that while many of these metrics may be available, it would be good if one part of the senior or one person from the senior management is responsible for tracking these metrics or championing this cause for the enterprise, and who is a point contact for you to give all the data on your social impact. So that's pretty much it from the presentation perspective. What we would now want you to do is, can you create a draft social impact framework for yourself? I might stop after lunch, but still.
What we do is we do it in a similar format where you have people sitting in the room and you can focus. I don't know what to do.
And it's just for you to get an initial focus on the
wire. Yeah, we will hang up with the
room. Some of the indicators, for example, could be, you know, your government indicators, which are published annually. If you are creating employment and those would be empty. For example, your as that of said, tracking mechanisms could be only done annually. But I mean, that would, I mean, it's just a logical way of doing things. There are 2-5 goals. Each activity has, each goal has a set of activities. There are all of those. There are indicators and then you track them.
It's actually an important tool that you have when you communicate your story to people. Because you have your impact that you create. If you say it in a very comprehensive manner, you have not only worked in creating that impact, but you are also successful in communicating the impact that you create. So, same groups, same set of moderators. If you still have the sheet from the morning, all you can do is just flip it around. There's a blank. The sheet is blank in the back. You can start from there.
First time I came to me to your video. You are somebody from your team went to the village. When I came with the video, I saw that video where the farmer was telling me to do water and so much. When the dog makes a light, the first time I realized that I am not so good. So, Santa, video.
So we can do that for the next 1 hour, but I think like Raghav was saying, it's really important for you to be as comprehensive as possible but focused. You know, don't try to tackle everything under the sun. There are only a few things people care about or you care
about. And it's also for managing.
So
if you have 20 indicators, how easy or will you have enough time every quarter to actually complete those 20 indicators? And maybe not. But the good thing is, if you start comprehensively and then you try and focus and say, okay, these are the 6 or 8 or 10 things that I actually want to focus on. And again, it's evolving. You could want to add an indicator later down the line. But the beauty of it is, it's yours, you created it, you can change it.
This exercise will help you understand your social impact that you create in a little more comfortable manner. If you want to do it yourself, the way we are asking you to do or at least guiding you, this is one way of doing it. You can at the same time, after this workshop, after this 1 hour, you can also check out the other two off-the-shelf products available in the market. You can see what's there. So the idea is to get you to think of this as a concept which will help you in your business. You sell your business not only to the consumers, the producers, the investors, but to the all the community stakeholders that you operate.
Actually, there's one thing that's different about your business, even from a business plan perspective that we were talking about this morning. What social enterprises can claim, which no other business on this planet can claim, is the impact that you're creating. And once you're measuring it in a format which is more methodical, quantitative, you can include it as a part of your business plan. It should ideally go and feedback into your business plan as a head, separately. And the more vaguely you manage it and measure it, the less trust people have. The more you do it in a more quantitative manner, the better people believe your story when you can show it on paper and track it actually. So think of it as a tool. When we were developing this, we have actually already, just for your information, we've already deployed this tool in a couple of investing companies of Avishka. Avishka is a fund. So we've already worked with quite a few investing companies and we have deployed it and they are using it. And when we were developing this framework, we looked at gears and iris for you. So because we wanted to create something that was much simpler to use and easier for you to manage. So we did look at all the frameworks that are already existing off the shelf and we thought that this was the best compromise between being a little bit more thorough and yet not making it administratively burdensome. So this is what we came up with, and I guess you will tell us how easy it is to do when you go through this exercise. Right? Great, so moderators can go back and
do you guys have that sheet from now?
Yeah.
Or you need another sheet of paper?
First of all, you have mission or vision. I'm sure you would have it in your mind. So, could you just put down the mission and vision? That would be the best answer.
What kind of treatment are you providing?
So,
first go off of it. Reduce the environmental.
In case you are going to be actively making these frameworks for yourself going forward. So thank you very much. It has been a pleasure interacting with you guys and knowing your businesses. So in case you have any more questions, we are hanging around, you can just ask or get time for anyone. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I'm
like,